And she was really excited. She rolls down her window and starts waving and says, "Yes, yes, I love Jesus too." Wouldn't you know it? A lot of other people love Jesus too. And everybody started honking. She was so excited that everybody loved Jesus. In fact, one man in excitement said, "Jesus Christ." He was so excited, she thought. After all that love that they had shared that Easter morning, she felt bad that she was the only one to make it through that intersection. So she pulled over to the side of the road and waved one last time at every honk how much they love Jesus. Grace and peace to you from God the Father and from our Lord and from our Savior, Jesus, who is the Christ. Amen. This is the day. This is the day that we get excited about. This is the day that I look forward to most out of our entire church season. We had the Church of the Covenant came together on Thursday night. We came together on Friday night. But without Easter Sunday, without the resurrection, there is no reason for us to gather. Without the empty tomb, the purpose of our church, the mission of our church, is frankly hollow. So we are gathered here this morning to profess Christ is risen, that the tomb is empty, and because of that, we have purpose, we have meaning in this life. This Easter Sunday is a special one. It's not only Easter Sunday, but it's also April 1st. You must not have had any tricks played on you quite yet this morning. April Fool's Day is personally one of my favorite holidays. I love practical jokes. And I'm just going to warn you, this is my second Easter here, so you all are fair game now. We've known each other long enough. But I love playing jokes on people, and I think the person that I played the most jokes on is my mom. For some reason, my mom, she's an easy target for these types of jokes. And I've done it enough now where she sees me coming from a mile away, but every year I like to play jokes on her. One in particular, I think it was about 5 years ago, Benny was just born, and I think I texted my mom and my dad with the news that the Lutheran Church had decided I should become a missionary and they were sending me to Africa. She lost her mind. She said, "I just got you back in Nebraska, now you're going off to Africa." I can't play those tricks on her anymore. But this morning we gathered. And I can't help but to think, as the disciples and Mary Magdalene came to that tomb, they had to wonder, is this a trick? Is this a version of April Fool's? Where had Jesus been taken? Had they removed the body? Was this some type of trick that either the Romans were playing on them or the disciples were somehow doing something? This whole concept of the dead Jesus no longer being there. This had never happened before. Mortality had a 100% winning record up until this point. We live, we breathe, and we die, and we stay dead. People are not supposed to rise again from the dead. And so when the disciples and Peter and Mary come there, they have to be thinking, what is going on here? The power of death is final. It is complete. And when they get there, they won't understand what is going on. In fact, Luke's gospel tells us that when the women first come and tell the disciples, they kind of scoff at the women, saying, "Well, just women telling idle tales." And the book of Acts tells us a little bit more. Jesus will appear to many, many people. And even after seeing Jesus face to face and seeing the holes in his wrist and his side and his feet, even then, not all believe. I think for us 2,000 years ago, it's hard for us to understand just how radical this is, just how unexpected this whole thing is. The power of the empty tomb is for us. It's for our lives. It's for our mission. It propels us forward in this life in love, compassion, openness, forgiveness. The open tomb should be our calling card. It should be the reason we want to come here each and every Sunday. It should be the reason we want to open our Bible. Bibles and just scream out hallelujah each and every day. I heard a very sad statistic about 3 or 4 weeks ago. The CDC tracks a lot of different things, and one of the really sad, startling things that's been going on here in America is the rise of suicides. And I don't really know what's causing it, but the latest numbers, 2016, over a 10-year span from 2006 to 2016, teenagers and young people, the rise has been 70%. 70. It's terrible. And so many communities have dealt with it. I have dealt with it. My internship church lost a 13-year-old young man, Dawson. An amazing young man. And it has just torn that community apart. And we wonder why. What is causing this? What has caused so much depression, so much sorrow? What is causing this? There's a few theories. The most common theory, one of the most common theories, is because of the economy. 2009, the economy tanked, and it's caused a lot of angst and a lot of turmoil in our communities, but that doesn't really hold up, does it? After all, the economy crashed in 2009. You'd expect for those rates to improve. The second thought is maybe it's because of drugs, but truth be told, youth using alcohol and cigarettes and drugs has actually been declining. And I know that we're really in the midst of an opioid crisis here, but as a country, we've seen the use of alcohol and drugs continue to decline, so we don't really think it's necessarily that. Another thought, and I was talking to Corey about this, is the rise of social media. You know, as kids go to school and they're kind of bullied there at school, they used to be able to come home and leave it all behind them, where they loved at home unconditionally. And social media, they come home with Facebook and Twitter, that bullying cycle goes on 24 hours each and every day. That might be part of it. But I think there's something that we're missing. Spiritual, but not religious. Where are these places that they can come and learn about the love of God? This is what this church is for. To rally around each other, to learn about God's love, to learn about the empty tomb, and because of that, we have purpose. We have mission. That Jesus has called us, and Jesus is pushing us forward in this life and into the life. Our purpose, our mission as Christians is to be compassionate in our community, to be forgiving in our community. Now back to that empty tomb. As they looked at that tomb and they wondered, is this all a trick? The one thing that has always convinced me most that this faith is real, the one thing that has caught me more than anything else, that when we proclaim that Jesus is risen, more than any other proof or more than any other argument that someone can give you, put yourself back there 2,000 years ago. Would you give your life to an April Fool's joke? Would you dedicate your entire self to preaching the tomb was empty if you knew it was false? All 11 disciples will give their lives to this faith. Each and every one of them will experience the risen Lord. Each and every one of them will go to all corners of this world proclaiming that Christ is risen. And because of that, God loves you. The tomb is empty. It is real. I have seen them face to face. Every one of them will give their lives to this. I sure want to go for an April Fool's joke. They saw it face to face. He is risen. And because of that, we know God loves you. He loves you today, He loves you tomorrow, and He will always love you. Amen?
Amen.